Let's get straight to the point. The photos you're looking at are from the photo session that I did with my friends recently at home with a couple of video lights. The main reason why I didn't use any flash or speed light is because I don't have them, but I have a whole bunch of video lights, and I think the results look very good, at least to me. By the way, all the photos are straight out of camera with zero editing. As I said in my previous videos, if you can get the look you want in camera, the less you need to edit the photos or videos in post. In this case, I didn't even do any editing and the photos look very nice to me and my friends. Yes, it was very difficult back in the days if you want to use continuous video lights for portrait photos because the light bulbs get too hot and the old LED lights were not color accurate or not powerful enough. But with today's video light technology and quality, it is definitely doable. Before we talk about how I set up the video lights, I need to apologize because I was too busy to record the behind the scene footage on the day of the photo session, but I will re-set up the lights to show you what happened that day. The only difference is that I'm not going to set up the backdrop this time because I'm not taking any photos this time. So imagine there is a row of backdrop instead of the plain wall that I have in this video. All the lights were set up in the exact same way. The first thing you need is the key light, and it has to be a very powerful light because if you want a very clean look on the subject and also the backdrop, the light has to be powerful enough to light up both the subject and the backdrop, or else the backdrop will always be too dim even if it is just a white background. A very bright key light will get rid of a lot of flaws like wrinkles on the backdrop. The key light I'm using is the Godox SC150R RGB video light. This is the most powerful video light I have, and it has 150 watts of output. You also need a big light modifier in order to soften the light and create a big light source to light up the subject. The bigger the light modifier, the softer the light, but the more powerful the light it needs to be. I had the SC150R at 100% the whole time during the photo session. This way, I was able to have the ISO of my camera as low as possible to have the cleanest image out of the camera. The modifier I used was a newer light dome that I use for my YouTube videos. I think it is about 36 inches big diagonally, and I had it placed as close as I could to the subject's face to keep the light soft. The closer the light source, the softer the light. The key light was about 2 feet away from the subject, just barely out of the frame when I was taking photos. One main thing you will notice having a big light source is that the key light will give a very nice and big catch light on the subject's eyes. The light reflection will really give the photo the life or soul to connect to the viewers, so try to get a big catch light if you can. Just like lighting a subject in a video, I had the key light aiming downwards at about 45 degrees to the subject to create a more dramatic effect with one side of the subject's face showing a little bit of shadows. This will create a more 3D look to the subject's face, and we'll talk about how to make it even more 3D with the second light. With just one powerful key light, I was able to light up both the subject and the backdrop already. But to make your photo look even better with a 3D pop, I added a second light at the back right across from the key light to create a hair/edge light to separate the subject from the background. You'll see that the edge light is lighting up the subject's shoulder and hair, giving them a very nice highlight. It is also wrapping around the subject's forehead and cheek, which is absolutely beautiful, especially for girls with nice hair and makeup. The edge light really enhances the texture of the hair instead of blending all the hair into one piece. The light I was using as the edge light is the Godox SL60W, which is a simple daylight balance video light that I have been using for the past couple of years. I had a simple light reflector on the edge light because you actually want something harsh instead of soft, so a simple light reflector will do, and it allows me to aim the light at the shoulder of the subject from behind. I had the edge light also pointing downwards directly across from the key light. This setup is pretty easy to remember, just point both lights downward at around 45 degrees directly across from each other. I had the edge light set to only 10% of power because you don't need that bright of an edge light, especially when it is a harsh light. Those were the lights that I used for the entire photo session, and the results were absolutely amazing. The biggest benefit of using constant video lights instead of flash or speed light is what you see is what you get. You don't have to test the light to see if they are bright enough or not because you literally get what you see in front of you and the camera. And it's also very easy to adjust the angle of the lights because again, you're looking at the result when you are moving the lights. If you use flashlights, you will have to move the lights, test them by taking a photo, and move them again and test them again if they don't look the way you want in the photo, which can take some time. Don't get me wrong, I admire photographers who use flashlights because it is not easy and it can definitely look more stunning compared to using video lights. Using flashlights is better in some cases because you don't need to have a constant power source for the lights and they are usually smaller and more mobile for outdoor use as well. I just don't have the money to buy them and I have a lot of video lights. For regular portrait photos, this setup is good enough. One thing to keep in mind is to use the most powerful light as the key light because it has to go through a modifier. We also tried doing some beauty photos with one extra accessory, not a light, just a reflector. For beauty photos, usually people want to eliminate as much shadows on the subject's face as possible because they want to showcase their makeup and a flawless face. The two light setup we had will create some dramatic shadows on the subject's face because the key light is pointing downward at an angle. We just need to get rid of those shadows. In order to do that in a very low budget way is to have a big reflector right below the subject's face. I had a huge reflector and I did not have any reflector holders, so I had it sitting on top of a stool and I asked my friend to hold it in place with their hands. I know it is not very professional looking, but it worked, and it worked very well. The reflector at the bottom will bounce the light off of the key light and light up the subject's face from the bottom, which eliminates most of the shadows on their face. This will give a very clean and bright look to the subject and really highlights the makeup and facial features. I was very, very surprised by how good it turned out. Just like having a big and soft key light source, try to get a bigger reflector when you are bouncing lights to get a softer light. If the reflector is too small, the bounce light will be too harsh or not as flattering. One more thing I did was to move the key light from a 45 degree angle to directly above and in front of the subject's face. This is to eliminate any shadows when the light was at an angle, let's say the shadow of the nose. One easy way to remember how to set up beauty light is to have the key light and the reflector set up like a clamshell. That's what this kind of setup is called too, clamshell lighting. I didn't change anything on the edge light because it looks good for a beauty setup just like the portrait setup. It is giving a very nice kiss of light on the subject's hair, shoulder, and cheekbone. One last setup I tried during the photo session only required one light, which is the key light. I removed the reflector, turned off the edge light because this time I want to take photos with a colored key light. Since the SE150R is a RGB video light, I was able to set it at any colors I want with a couple of button presses. This is also why I was using a RGB video light as the key light so I can completely change the color of the scene very quickly without having to fiddle with color gels. This is another huge advantage of using video lights for photos because with flashlights, you will have to use color gels to change the color of the light. At least that's what I remember. I had the key light set to red, purple, blue throughout the session and the results look absolutely amazing. Since the key light was super powerful, I was able to light up the subject in a different color and also change the color of the backdrop very nicely because the backdrop was just a plain white background. One reason why I turned off the edge light is because the light I was using is just a daylight color video light and it will wash out the RGB colors from the key light if I kept it on. Also, by not using an edge light, I was able to create a very moody and high contrast look that looks almost like a silhouette, which is very cool. One thing to keep in mind when you are using the RGB function of most consumer video lights is the power output will be much lower and the light coming out will be much dimmer, so don't expect it to be as bright as the daylight color. That's it. That's how I was using my continuous video lights for portrait photos. I don't know if the photos are good for professional uses, but my friends and I were very happy with the results. Again, using video lights is much easier because what you see is what you get, and you can change the color of the lights if they are RGB enabled. Also, you can use this light setup for videos, of course, because they are video lights, but you cannot really use flashlights for videos, so you have two uses out of one light. The concept to light a video is pretty much the same as photos, at least for the looks I like. The main drawback is you need constant power supply for the video lights, and they are most likely not mobile and powerful enough to be used outdoor against sunlight. But they are definitely good enough to me for indoor photos. Let us know if you want to see more tutorials like this in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.